Hello everybody and a very good morning to one and all. I welcome you one and all for this webinar on cybersecurity challenges during COVID-19. It's my immense pleasure to welcome you one and all. Prayer is the source of strength and the power for our living. I take immense pleasure in welcoming Professor Sharon Nisha for invocation of the prayer. Prayer by Professor Sharon Nisha.
Prayer. Loving and most gracious Heavenly Father, our Lord Jesus Christ, we thank you and praise you, Lord, for this wonderful moment you have given to look to your face. At the start of this webinar, we look to your face. As your word says, every good gift and every perfect gift is from above and comes down from the Father of lights. Lord, we pray that you will bless this webinar and make it a wonderful and a perfect one. We pray for the organizers, participants, and the resource person. Grant us your wisdom, knowledge, and strength. Bless us, lead us, and guide us. Let your will be done and your name be magnified. We offer all this prayer in the most precious name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
At the outset, with a grateful heart to the Lord Almighty, I take immense pleasure in welcoming you one and all to this webinar, which is the cybersecurity challenges during COVID-19. Which is a very apt topic for this current time. It's my immense pleasure to welcome you one and all to this webinar. First of all, I place on record my gratitude to the management of Francis Xavier Engineering College. I thank our chairman, Dr. S. Cletus Babu, and our managing director, Engineer C. Arun Babu, for all the support for the connect of this webinar. Also, it's my honor to thank Dr. K. Jaykumar for all the support and for all the motivation and for all the initiative he has provided and for all the guidance he has provided in conducting all these webinars. Also, it's my privilege to welcome Dr. Velmurugan, the principal of Francis Xavier Engineering College, for his constant support in conducting all this webinar in a very meticulous manner. It's my honor and my privilege to welcome Professor P. Brinda, the HOD of Computer Science and Engineering Department, for all her tireless effort in conducting all these webinars in a very successful manner. It's my honor to welcome the resource person of this webinar, Dr. Emeline Shiny Madam, who has come here to share her expertise and her knowledge with us. I welcome you, Madam, to this August gathering and also to this webinar. And I thank you so much for consenting to come as a resource person and share your knowledge with us. Welcome you, ma'am, to this webinar. Also, it's my immense pleasure to welcome all my colleagues and comrades of Computer Science and Engineering Department, and the coordinator, Professor Sharon Nisha Ma'am, also to this August gathering. Last but not the least, it's my great privilege to welcome you one and all, the participants of this webinar, who have come here to receive the knowledge. I'm sure that you will certainly be enriched with the knowledge of this webinar, and this webinar will be thought-provoking and be an inspiring one in the career, in your career, and also in all the endeavors which you are pursuing. With these words of welcome, I take honor in introducing the resource person of this webinar. Dr. C. Emeline Shiny is a young and dynamic computer professional with over 22 years of teaching experience. She is currently working as a professor in the Department of Computer Science and Engineering in East Point College of Engineering and Technology, Bangalore. She was awarded doctorate in Anna University in the year 2013. And she is a Cisco certified professional for the specialization of cyber operations. Her research area is cyber security. She has published more than 30 international journals and presented papers in more than 40 national and international conferences. She is the author of the book called Cyber Forensics. She is guiding the research scholars and her passion is teaching. And we are so honored to have Madam as the resource person for this webinar. I thank you, Ma'am, for consenting to be the resource person for this webinar. And I welcome Dr. C. Emeline Shiny Ma'am, to take over the session. Over to Dr. C. Emeline Shiny Ma'am from Bangalore.
Okay, thank you. I thank the management principal of Francis Xavier Engineering College for giving me this opportunity I also thank HOD CSE and the coordinators, Professor Arvind sir and Professor Sharon madam. So we'll start the session, cybersecurity challenges during COVID-19. So for the past 4 months, everyone are struggling with this COVID-19 coronavirus, and people are unusually curious in reading news articles and research papers on this pandemic. Some have ventured into researching on this virus to gather information as much as possible. So this coronavirus pandemic has created a perfect storm of a global news event, together with dramatic changes in working practices and the technologies used by the organization. And everyone are very busy nowadays to get the update about the coronavirus. What is the status of today? What is the status of yesterday? Whether it got reduced or whether it got increased? And what about that particular country? It's reduced or not? Suppose it got reduced, what are the methods they have followed to reduce the coronavirus? Like that, people are very busy in that, right? So here, at the same time, right, people are very busy in providing, that is, safety measure for each and everyone. At the same time, right, it's affected the economy, it affects the political, it affects the social systems, it affected the health. At the same time, some people are actively creating some attacks and stealing some personal information of the users, customers, etc. Right? Stealing personal information means stealing the confidential data of the user. Right? So confidential data means their user ID, their password, then their credit card information, etc. Right? Who are these people? Who are these people are actively doing some attacks? That people are called as cyber criminals. Okay, so these cyber criminals are creating some attacks that is called as cyber attacks. Okay, so that only I have given this slide. It's disturbing global health, economic, political, social system. But there is another unseen threat rising in the digital space, that is the risk of cyber attacks. Right. So first we'll see what is cyber attacks. Then we will see what are all the cyber attacks happening during this pandemic. Okay, so here, what is cyber attack? Cyber attack means it is an attempt to disable the computers for stealing the data. Okay, as I said already, stealing their personal data, that is stealing the confidential data, otherwise we can say the sensitive information. Okay, for this, cyber criminals are using variety of methods. Variety of method means variety of attacks. They are using them, right? So man in the middle attack available, denial of service attack available, phishing available, smishing available, right? SQL injection available. There are a list of attacks available. I have given here malware, phishing, ransomware, man in the middle attack, right? So this is the general about the cyber attack. Okay. So here, a security company has tracked coronavirus keywords to determine that over 3 lakh suspicious COVID-19 websites have been created between March 9 and March 23. So March 9 and March 23 means it is only the 14 days. Within these 14 days, 3 lakh suspicious websites have been created, okay, regarding coronavirus, right? So how from this we came to know how the cyber criminals are actively doing their part, right? The 3 lakh suspicious websites have been created between March and March 9th and March 23. And here I listed out some of the attacks, date-wise attacks, and there are a lot of attacks available from March till July, right? But here I have specified very little. The 13th March, the attack happened. The type of the attack is ransomware. Then again, 13th March, one more attack regarding with the coronavirus. That is the phishing attack. Then again, 18th March, malware attack. The 19th March, targeted attack. Then again, 20th March, phishing. 21st March, scam, phishing. Then 7th April, malware. Okay. Then again, 7th April, malware. Then 16th April, phishing. Then 17th April phishing, 8th May is phishing, then 11th May malware, again 16th May there's a important Trojan, then 20th May is also important Trojan. Okay, these are all the some of the very little attacks created between from March till July. Okay, so here given the uncertainty about COVID-19, people are curious to know more about it and how to keep themselves safe, right? So using this major disaster, hackers, criminals, scammers, plays with human emotions by generating curiosity, fear, and urgency through emails with attachments, right? We know that we are receiving the email. Suppose the email, the particular email is creating some fear and creating some urgency, means if there is any attachment available in that email, you should not open that, right? The cyber criminals are normally, they will create the fear, okay? They will create the urgency. I'll explain the example, that's the online shopping, right? So we are purchasing the product. Suppose if we are looking at a particular product and we didn't buy that product, means for the continuous 10 days or 15 days, it will show that particular product repeatedly, okay? At the same time, sometimes it will say only 1 hour left, right? Only 50 minutes left, only 30 minutes left. This much of people bought this product, so you can buy this, like that it will stay. Suppose if it is creating some urgency, means urgency to pay this product, immediately you should stop in that, okay? We have to stop in that. We should analyze that, what is that, why it is creating urgency, why it is there is any important in that, like that we should analyze, then we go for the next action, right? Then, so here the second point, you can say that, you can see that there is for the email, the attachments are coming. It may be in the PDF form, it may be in the PPT or in the doc file, right? So on the pretext of sharing, of obtaining information related to COVID-19. So cyber criminals are creating the fear, creating the urgency to open the attachment. If you open the attachment, immediately the particular malware will inject our system, okay? Then, so from this survey, what survey? Here I have specified some of the attacks, right? From that survey, we can see many of the attack is phishing. Okay, see here, there are three phishing available, and this page also, there are three phishing available. So from the survey, the major cyber attack during COVID-19 is phishing. So first we will see about the phishing, right? How the phishing attacks are happening, how the cyber criminals are creating the phishing attack, then how to protect us from the phishing, okay? So what is phishing, right? Phishing is a technique of tricking the people into giving sensitive information, right? It tricks the people to give their user ID, their banking details, their credit card details, their account transaction details, etc. Okay, in what form this phishing is creating? Okay, it is creating in the form of email, it is creating in the form of websites, it is creating in the form of instant messaging, right? So for example, phishing site. What is that phishing site? What is that fake site, right? It is a illegitimate website, okay? But look and feel is same. Look and feel is same. It looks like a original website, right? For example, you can take a particular bank, Indian Overseas Bank or ICICI Bank. It looks like that particular page looks like a original page, but it is not a original page. It is a illegitimate page. Okay, that is a phishing website. The look and feel is same, but it is not the original one, right? So that's a fake website or the phishing website. It is in the form of email, or it is in the form of messaging, or in the form of websites itself, to get the username, password, credit card details, sensitive bank information, etc. Here we can see one example. I have given only one example here. It is the Facebook page, right? So normally if we see this, we will think that it is our original Facebook page, right? Here everything, we can, there is a Facebook and the email address, password available, but it is not the original Facebook page, right? So here you can see that in the URL, www.facebook, right? It is not Facebook, it's given Facebook. So for this particular page, they have created like it's a Facebook page, right? Suppose by mistake we have given Facebook, it will open this page, but we will not know that. We will give our email address, we will give our password. So the in between, the hackers will sit and they will hack our email ID and the password, and original, our original Facebook page will be hacked, Okay, original Facebook page will be had. So here, what is the main important thing? Means there is a URL. Okay, normally users will not see the URL. People will not see the URL. Just will see the page only. Here, we have to see the URL, whether it is the correct URL or not. Okay, whether it is our original Facebook page or not, whether it is www.facebook.com or not, right? But here it is a Facebook, so we have to see the URL before giving our user ID, password, etc. Okay, this is one form of phishing, right? Look and feel is same, right? It looks like a original page, so look and feel is same. Then, so in this phishing, right, the phishing is attacks in the form of in different ways, right? So here there is two terms we should know. What is the blacklist and what is whitelist? Okay, blacklist means that's the database. It consists of illegitimate URLs. Okay, whitelist means it's the database. It consists of legitimate URL sites, right? So legitimate URL sites, that's the whitelist. And the illegitimate URL, that's the blacklist. Okay. Suppose we don't know whether it is a original URL or it is the illegitimate URL. You can go to the fish tank. Okay. You can go to the fish tank and you can see that whether it is the original one or it's the illegitimate one. It contains all the illegitimate URL as well as all the original URLs also. At the same time, you can go for Google Safe browsing also. Here also, all the blocklisted URLs available. From there, we can find out that whether it's a illegitimate one or it is the original one. Okay. So these are two terms we should know, that is the blacklist and the next one is the whitelist. Okay. So different form of phishing attacks, I said already. The first one is the URL based and the next one is the hyperlink based. And the third one is the email based. Okay. So URL based, hyperlink based, email based. First, we'll see the URL based. See here, a simple technique to find phishing URLs. Okay. There are some suspicious URL I have given here. The first type, you can see that HTTP, www. Then there is some word, .com, .login, .net. Right, there are two domains present here, so it is a suspicious URL. Okay, it's a suspicious URL. And the next one you can see here, www.usa-passport-online-apply.com. There are a lot of hyphens available, more than two hyphens, so we can say this is a suspicious URL. And the next one you can see, citibank-cgi.net, right? This CGI word normally is a phishing string word. Okay, it is a phishing string. Suppose if the URL contains the CGI word, you should be alert. It is a suspicious URL. Okay, then see here, a dotted decimal number IP address is used instead of the domain name. Okay, instead of domain name, here the IP address is used. Right, then there may be small differences in spelling, like OneOB, which is the duplicate URL of iob.com. www.iob.com, that is our original URL. Instead of I, the hackers are using one. Okay. Instead of I, they are using one. But we will not see that clearly. So www.oneob.com, it is a phishing URL. But we will not find out easily. One and I, it's not much difference. Okay. Then the sixth one. The given URL redirects the HTTP request from the legitimate website to some other phishing website. Okay. So here you can see pan.com. Then it is redirecting to some other site. That is 200, 251, 251, 12. Okay. So when we see that it's the original one, but from that, right, it is redirecting to the phishing website, illegitimate website. Okay. Then the seventh one, the phishers may lead and prompt the client to visit a fake website using fake URLs. Okay, this is a fake URL, sbibank.com.change.com, it's a fake URL. So these are some of the suspicious URLs I have given here, but we need to be very cautious when we use the URL. Okay, when we use some website, we have to be very cautious in that. right? So the first one is the in the phishing, the first method is the URL based attack. It's a suspicious URL. Then the next one is the hyperlink verification. What is hyperlink? That everyone knows that. That is in the web page or in some email, some hyperlink will come, right? Some link will come. When you click that link, it will go to some other page, etc. Okay. So in this hyperlink also, what are all the things we should see? Normally, what are all the things we have to check, right? So the hyperlink verification, we have to check what protocol they have used. Right, HTTP, HTTPS, what protocol they have used, then what's the domain name they have used, then if they have used more than one domain name, and we have to check that whether they have used any fake domain name, right, then what are all the parameters they have used in the hyperlink, then what is the actual link, and what is the visible word, okay. Normally, hackers, what they will do means, the visible word is the particular original word, okay. From that word, the link will go to that phishing site, okay, illegitimate site. So what is the visible word and what is the actual link that we have to note it down. Then compare actual and visible link and display the comments if both are the URL. These are the some of the verifications for the hyperlink, okay. So we have seen that how we have to verify the URL, how we have to verify the hyperlink. And the next one is the suspicious behavior, okay. Here I have given some suspicious behavior of the websites, right. The first one is the zero iteration, nil iteration. What is the zero iteration or nil iteration means? Actually, in the website, there are a lot of pages available. You take some particular page, for example, you take a particular first page, okay. The link, it will not come to the particular first page, will not again. There are 10 pages available, okay. It will go to, from first page, it will go to the third page, then third page, it will go to the fourth page, some sixth page like that. It will not come to the particular page again, right? It will not come to the particular page again. That is the nil iteration or the zero iteration. Then solitary iteration means it will only once, right? Only once it will visit that particular page again. Then numerous iteration means more than one time it will visit that particular page. Okay. So I think, hope you are understanding that the particular websites contains lot of pages available, right? So from the, suppose we are using the first page, that particular link, it will not come again to that first page, right? It is called as nil iteration. Sometimes it's pointing only one time, that is called solitary iteration. Then suppose it's pointing more than one time, it is the numerous iteration. Okay. Then highest number of form posting. Okay. How many forms they have used in that particular web page? That is the highest number of form posting. Then highest number of mistakes for that particular website. Then feedback with the given input. How many feedbacks available for the given input, right? Then linking images. Normally, websites consists of images, and some websites consists of the particular, if you click that particular image, it will go to that particular site, okay? So linking the images. Then text-only content. So some pages consists of, some websites consists of only the text. It will not contain the images, okay? These are all the behaviors. These are all the suspicious behavior we have taken that. So here I have taken 8, okay? I have taken 8. You can take any number, and that's according to our wish. And this, with this 8th iteration, 8th combination, how to do the classification algorithms, right? For example, decision tree, neural network, like that you can use classification algorithm and you can come to a conclusion that whether it is a phishing site or it is a original site. We are not going to see that classification algorithms and working out and all. Here we are going to see what are all the attacks happening during this pandemic, okay? So I will show only that after the classification, after the combination, how it is predicting, that only I will show here. See here, this is the phishing websites, okay? H1, H2, H3, these are all the suspicious combinations, what I have shown it in the previous slide. The H1 is the nil iteration, H2 is the solitary iteration, then H3 is the numerous iteration, then H4 is the highest number of posting, and H5 is the number of mistakes, then H6 is the feedback, then H7 is the linking images, then H8 is text-only content. Okay, these are all the 8 combinations, H1 to H8. Now I have taken the list of URLs, thousands of URLs I have taken. Then I have do some classification algorithms in this. So after the classification algorithms, these URLs are saying that it's a phishing URL. Okay, so these URLs are saying that it's a phishing URL. Now you can go move to the next slide. See here, it is a legitimate website. Okay, legitimate websites. So these URLs, all the combinations that I have used, and the answer, the solution we are getting, that these URLs are the not the phishing URL, it is the legitimate URL, okay, original URLs, right? So in this way, you can find out whether this is the phishing website or it is the original website, right? So this is one method of finding that, right? So we have seen that URL-based hyperlink verification, then how to, based on the suspicious behavior, we came to the conclusion that whether it is a phishing URL or it's a legitimate URL. Now we are moving to the email phishing. Okay, email phishing is a very dangerous one because email is a main mode of communication everywhere. Okay. Yeah, whether it's WhatsApp available or Telegram available or SMS available, whatever way, the email is the main mode of communication officially. Okay, in corporates we are using the email, and for the education, for everywhere, for the official communication, we will use the email only. So hackers are also using this email for to get our personal data. Okay. So phishing email attempts to fraudulently acquire personal information such as our account password or credit card information, right? The email may look like a legitimate source, but actually it is not, right? It looks like from the original source. For example, nowadays in the pandemic period, many emails are coming like from WHO, that is World Health Organization. But it is not from World Health Organization, but in between the hackers are sending the emails like that, okay? So email may look like it's a original source. Now, see here, so if we receive an email, particular email, what are all the things we should note it down, right? We have to check the subject of the email, okay? We have to check the subject of the email. If it says it's urgent email, right? Like that, if it is creating some urgency or creating some, it's given some threatening word, then immediately you should close that email. You have to, you should not open that. Okay. So the subject is the very important one. Then legitimacy in content. The content also you have to see before you open the attachment. Okay. Suppose, what is that phishing keyword? Okay, account, user, bank, credit card. These are all the some of the words they will use in that email, in the content. Your account is going to close. So we need these following details immediately within 1 hour. Then only your account will be get saved. Like that, you will get the email messages. So these are all the phishing keyword: account, bank, user, credit card, sensitive, confidential. These are all the phishing keyword. We have to be very careful. If we receive the email like that with that phishing keywords, we should not open the attachment, right? Then we have to check the IP address also, from where that email has received. We can check the IP address in the spamhas.org. Okay, whether it is you can verify the IP address there, right? So these are all the things you have to check in your email. That is the main thing is subject and to the content of the email, and the next one is the IP address before opening the attachments. Okay, before opening the attachments. The attachments may be in the PDF form or in the doc form or in the PPT form, in any form, you should not open that. Okay. So here, now see here, phishing domain threats. during COVID-19. Okay, Indian cybercrime official released a list of potential dangerous coronavirus related domains to be aware of. Okay, these are all the some of the domain names created by the cyber criminals, right, during COVID-19. Okay, see here, coronavirus status dot space. If we see the coronavirus, immediately we will open that and we will see that what are all the things given here. Okay, but it's a phishing website. Okay, right, coronavirus status dot space, then coronavirus hyphen map.com, right, then canelero.digital, then coronavirus.zone. Okay, what do you will think that zone wise detail, maybe it's a zone wise detail, we can see that our zone, what is the status, like that we will open that. Then coronavirus real time, then coronavirus.app, coronavirusware.xyz, then corona-virus.healthcare, right? If we see the healthcare, immediately we will read that what are all the health thing, safety measure we can follow, right? Then survivecoronavirus.org, then vaccinecoronavirus.com. It's an important one. If we see the vaccine, immediately we will open that because everyone are waiting the vaccination, right? Then coronavirus.cc, then bestcoronavirusprotect.tk, then coronavirusupdate.tk, right? These are the sum of the phishing websites, right? Phishing domain threats during COVID-19. Okay, so we need to be very careful. What are all the things we have to open? What are all the things we should not open that? Right, so here already I said that. So using World Health Organization mail in the name of COVID-19 as legit application by the fraudsters and spreading malware to control your end devices. So the emails look like it's from the WHO, from World Health Organization. See here, the email, little part I have given here, it's sent by a Tim Hardley, principal healthcare officer from WHO's regional office for the Americas. Okay, so here the Tim Hardley, the people will not be available. Okay, this healthcare officer will not be available, but the cyber criminals created like that, and we will not think that whether Tim Hardley available or not, we will not think that, we will just even open the chat. Okay, then a Google search throws up no results for the chat who are official, right? Then the attachment has malicious and delivered sophisticated multi-layer pin. Okay, easily we will not suspect that. So for every file before we opening, we should be very cautious in that. So we have seen the different types of phishing threats, right? Now we are moving to the malware threats, right? That is also during COVID-19. And you can see here, it's very interesting and it is very dangerous thing. The first thing you see that cyber criminals are using a phishing campaigns telling victims they have come in contact with someone diagnosed with COVID-19 and tricks them into downloading malware. So they are saying that your friend or your colleague diagnosed with COVID-19 and the details are available here. You open the attachment like that, they will give the email. And the second one, you can see the campaign pretends to be from a local hospital telling the recipient that they have been exposed to the coronavirus and that need to be tested. So like that, the emails are coming there, right? So definitely everyone will get tough, right? And immediately they will open that PDF file, whether they have given the PPT or in the doc file. And when open that particular attachment, immediately the malware will be injected into your device, right? It is in the mobile or it is your laptop or your desktop. It will be injected into your system. Okay, this is about the malware threats during this COVID-19. Okay, in different ways the threats are coming. Okay, so what we have to do, how you will protect yourself from these phishing and malware attacks, okay, from this phishing and from this malware threats, how we can protect us, we'll see that. So be aware of fraudulent emails claiming to be from expert. They might say that they have information about virus. Pay attention to the websites you go to. The URL is usually a dead giveaway. That is, if you're receiving the email and if they give you a link that if you click that link, you will get a lot of information about this virus, then immediately you should not click that link. You have to go to that particular website and have to check that whether that particular website is available or not. And we should see that whether that particular website is the legitimate one or the phishing one. Okay. Then do not click on any link from unknown sources. They could download malware and viruses on your computer or device, right? From unknown sources email, please, no need to open that. Then check the true destination of the link by hovering the pointer over the hyperlink. You have to check the destination from where it is coming, from where that particular link came, from where that particular email came, whether the particular original site is available or not, whether it is the trusted one, it's authorized site, like that we should check that, then only you have to proceed further, okay? Then how you will protect yourself from these phishing and malware attacks, there's a condition. Do not open the attachments or click on links in emails or text messages or social media messages from strangers, okay? Nowadays, a lot of social media messages are also, because everyone are in online now, right? It's in the digital space. Everyone are using the online. So social media messages also threatening that. So we have to be cautious in that. Then disconnect or delete any call or messages that ask for your personal or financial details. We know that many calls we are receiving that we are calling from the particular bank and we need your data, like that we are receiving the calls. If we receive the call, immediately we should cut that call. And if we're receiving any messages regarding that, we have to delete that message. Then if you think you have been a victim of a scam, then report to your bank immediately. So suppose if you are thinking that you are the victim, then immediately you should take action. We have to report to the particular bank, or if there is any other related information, means we have to report to the CIA based on the cyber law that we have to do. Okay. So this is about the phishing and the malware. Okay, so why we have started phishing and malware means that is in the first two slides I have shown that what are all the attacks happened from March till June. So main attacks I have shown that. So in the last, you would have seen that there are two attacks I have specified. The one is EventBot. Okay, EventBot is the main important threat. And it is a recent threat, and it is introduced in the pandemic period. Okay, it is introduced in this pandemic period, the EventBot threat creator. Okay, it's a new type of Android mobile malware that emerged around March 2020. Okay, it's created in March only. Then it is a mobile banking trojan. Okay, it's my mobile banking trojan. These are all the things we should know that, because we should be careful. Then it is info stealer that abuses Android's accessibility features to steal user data from financial applications. Okay, it's coming through email, it's coming through SMS. Okay, when you click that particular SMS, immediately that banking trojan is activated in your mobile and it steals all your financial data, right? This is the EventBot, and we will see the EventBot continuously. Okay, EventBot targets users of over 200 different financial applications. Okay, it's attacked 200 different financial applications. It's approximate number only. Okay, so the event, actually the threat is created in March only, but 200 different financial applications it's attacked, including banking, then money transfer services, cryptocurrency wallets, etc. Cryptocurrency means Bitcoin, Ethereum, then Litecoin, Steam, like that. Okay, then those targeted include applications like it's attacked the applications of PayPal, Business, then UniCredit, Capital One, TransferWise, HSBC, Coinbase, like that. It's attached lot of applications. Okay, in the next slide, I have shown what are the applications it attacked. I have shown the logo. Okay, so EventBot is actively it has done their part, even if it is created in March, right? So you can see here, targeted applications of event bot. These are all the applications, only the logo given here, okay? So numerous number of applications are targeted by the event bot. So event bot is a mobile banking Trojan. Okay, it's attacking our mobile system to steal the financial data, especially for the financial data, because it's the name given mobile banking. Okay, then it specially targets financial banking applications across the United States and Europe, including Italy, then Spain, etc. Okay, then EventBot threats, though EventBot is not currently on the Google Play Store, we were able to find several icons EventBot is using to masquerade as a legitimate application. Okay, it's a very important thing, right? Now we can't see the EventBot in the Google Play Store, but some icons are available. Okay, we can see these icons, right? So here the icons are specified here. There are four icons specified here. If you install these specified application also, the event bot automatically installed in your system. Okay, it's not specified as event bot specifically, but it's in the only the icon is given. Okay, only the icon given, and when you click that icon also, automatically the event bot will be created. Okay, now, so in this event bot, there are several versions available. Okay, for every software, there are versions available. Standard first version, then the 1.1 version, 1.2 version. And when you introduced a new version, new feature also introduced. Okay, but here in the same way, this attack, this threat is also having different versions available. Most of the attacks are having different versions available. Okay, different versions available. Each version's having different feature. Okay, advanced feature available, because their main, the cyber criminals' main aim is to attack the system, steal the financial data, right? So in that way, they will try. So there are different versions are introduced: 0.0.1, then 0.0.0.2, then 0.3.0.1, then 0.4.0.1. Okay, each version expands the bot's functionality and works to obfuscate the malware against analysis. Okay, each version consists of different functionality. Now, this is for our understanding, because I said already in the Google Play Store, EventBot it specified, it didn't specify through some icons the EventBot is introducing in our mobiles. So we have to be careful when installing particular app. These are all the permissions it's asking. We have to be careful in that. So I have showed here, right? So when installed EventBot, right, it requests the following permission. Right. So here it's asking the permission for the alert window, yes or no, then read external storage, then request install packages, then it's asking for the internet access, then for the battery optimizations, then wake clock, then access network state, then request companion run in background, then use data in background, then receive boot completed, and last is two. You can see that receiving SMS and the reading SMS, mainly the event bot, it is attacking through the SMS. Okay, so in the permission itself, it's given that receive SMS and the read SMS. So I said clearly, when you install in your system, suppose event bot, you are not knowing that it is the event bot, but if the permissions it's asking like this, means we have to be stop in that, and we have to analyze what is this. Okay, so it's a common features when installing that. Then when installing that, once installed, normally when we install the app, it will ask the accessibility services, isn't it? Like that also, it's asking the accessibility services. So EventBot prompts the user to give it access to the accessibility services. Then if you give yes, it will go to the next phase. So once the malware can use accessibility services, it has the ability to operate as a key logger, okay, and can retrieve the notifications about other installed applications and content of open Windows. Okay, so now after installing, it's able to retrieve the notifications of other applications which installed in our mobile. and it's able to access the information of the open windows. What are all the windows opened in our mobile? Okay, so we have to be very cautious in that when installing some app. Okay, then EvenBot, again it will ask one more thing. EvenBot will ask for permissions to run in the background before deleting itself from the launcher. That is, it will ask that let app always run in the background. Allowing flash update to always run in the background may reduce battery life. You can change this later from settings, app and notification. This permission it will ask, if you give allow, then immediately everything will be hacked. Okay, then here when the after installing the EvenBot, this is the background, okay, background code which is running, okay, background code which is running, what are all the details it's hacking, okay, that you see that blue color, that is OS, what is the OS you are using, what's the model, and what's the vendor, what's the applications, then GP status version, then botnet ID, botnet version, then live version, then screen lock type, right? Then recent data, everything. These are all the details will be gathered by that EvenBot from our mobile. Okay, then SMS grabbing. In the previous slide itself, we have seen that there is a permission for reading the SMS and receiving the SMS and for reading the SMS. So here SMS grabbing, EvenBot has the ability to pass the SMS messages. Okay, it's the ability to pass the SMS messages by using the targeted device SDK version to pass them correctly. So it is the part of the code. It's not the fully code. It's a part of the code. In this code, you can see that it is passing the SMS and retrieving that after clicking that particular link, retrieving what are all the informations it's needed, it will retrieve that information. Okay, that is about the SMS grabbing in the EvenBot. Okay, so what is the impact of the EvenBot? EvenBot is a mobile malware, as we said already. It's a mobile malware banking trojan that steals financial information. It is able to hijack the transactions also. Then once this malware has successfully installed, it will collect personal data, passwords, keystrokes, banking information, and all other confidential data. Okay, so what we have to do? Okay, what we have, how we can protect ourselves from this attack called the EvenBot. So what's the security tips for that EvenBot, right? Keep your mobile device up to date with the latest software updates from legitimate sources, right? So every time we used to say our software should be the updated one, but that also we should install from the legitimate source. Then keep Google Play Protect on. Do not download mobile apps from unofficial or unauthorized sources. Okay. Most legitimate Android apps are available on the Google Play Store. Then always apply critical thinking and consider whether you should give a certain app the permission it requests. So whenever it's asked the permission when installing the app, immediately you should think that whether it is needed or not. Right. If you have any doubt, if you are suspecting anything, you should stop in that. You have to analyze that. You have to go to that particular original website and you should analyze what are all the important things you have to find out. Then only you have to proceed. Right. Then when in doubt, check the APK signature mainly. Okay. And hash in sources like VirusTotal before installing on your device if you suspect. Then use mobile threat detection solutions for enhanced security. Okay. In this way, we can protect ourselves from the EvenBot mobile banking trojan, right? So we have seen that phishing, malware, and how we have to protect us ourselves from phishing, malware, etc. Then the important banking trojan, we have seen that is the EvenBot. Okay, EvenBot, it is introduced in March only during this pandemic. Okay, then the next mobile banking trojan is also the Cerberus. Okay, Cerberus also during this COVID-19, it's attacked enormously, right? It had a lot of data. Okay, so Cerberus is a well-known banking trojan for Android. Okay, it's also a banking trojan. Then its popularity has been growing rapidly in recent months. Okay, recent months means during this pandemic. Then CBI has warned state police and law enforcing agencies, as this is the third alert by Interpolis since the coronavirus pandemic began. Cerberus virus can enter phone by clicking on an SMS. Okay, it's coming through SMS only, right? When you click the SMS, and when you click the particular link in the SMS, immediately it will be installed in your device, okay, in your Android mobile, and all the financial data will be hacked, okay? Then a malware can be infected by hackers to steal financial data, okay? This is the Cerberus. So we'll kind of see continuously about the Cerberus. It takes advantage of COVID-19 pandemic to impersonate and send SMS. People are reading lots of articles and research papers online using this curiosity. So they send an SMS, and once clicks the link, she or he ends up downloading the embedded malicious link. The malware is then installed on your phone. As I said already, it's coming in the form of SMS. When you click the particular SMS and when you click the particular link, the particular malware will be injected. The malware is called the Cerberus. It will be injected in your Android mobile. Okay. So this Trojan primarily focuses on stealing financial data because it's a mobile banking Trojan, okay, such as credit card and debit card numbers. Then in addition to it, it can use overlay attacks to trick victims into providing personal information and capture two-factor authentication also, okay. It's capturing the two-factor authentication also, Cerberus, right? Then the important thing is in the Cerberus, right, there is an app created, but this app now it's not available in the Google Play Store. It was available only for some days, right? It is a cryptocurrency app. The Cerberus created, it's a cryptocurrency app. When you install this app, right, what's happening that we'll see in the next slide. See here. Okay, so Cerberus posing as cryptocurrency app. Researchers from Avast, they only found Cerberus malware application on Google Play Store. The malware hid behind a cryptocurrency converter app. Okay, it is for mainly converting the cryptocurrency. So cryptocurrency means, for example, Bitcoin, Ethereum, Litecoin, Steam, etc. Then it will be converted into fiat money. Okay, it will be converted into fiat money. So it seems that malware basically attempt to steal users' banking data, which the users would need to enter while converting their cryptocurrency to fiat money. So this also allowed the app to escape security check by Google Play Protect. Okay, so it was available for some days and it's converted many cryptocurrencies into fiat money. Okay, then so this malware disappeared, but the threat persists. Okay, it's disappeared from the Google Play Store, but still the threat available. Okay, though the active Cerberus malware functionality appeared for a very short time, the users must remain very careful while downloading any app, especially the ones dealing with sensitive information such as banking details. Okay, so whenever it's asking some banking details, credit card details, immediately we should stop in that. As I said already, we have to analyze, then only we should proceed. Okay, so right. So in the Cerberus, so we have seen that it is coming through SMS. Okay, then one more way it's threatening everyone through the remote access. Okay, this Cerberus is a remote access Trojan also. Okay, remote access Trojan. So how it is remotely accessing means through the TeamViewer. Okay, we know the TeamViewer is for the purpose of the remote access. Through the TeamViewer, it is creating the attack and it is controlling the whole device. Okay, it's controlling the whole device. Otherwise, it's controlling some files, accessing the some files. Otherwise, it's controlling the whole device with the user interface. Okay, so that only we are going to see. So it's detected include a RAT, that is a remote access Trojan. Then there are two new features have been introduced here. The first one, commands to access the device files. Okay, when introduce the remote access Trojan, that is remote access Cerberus Trojan in your system, it will access the particular files. Okay, that is command to access the device files, then commands to start the official TeamViewer application to take the full control of the device, including the user interface. Okay, not only accessing the files. There are two features, not only accessing the files, then it is accessing the whole device. That is, it's controlling the whole device. The whole control of the system will be available now with the hackers. Okay, the controlling the whole device with the user interface, right? So this is a very dangerous Trojan, because there is a remote access Trojan. It's a very dangerous one. Okay, then you can see here in the next slide. Okay, so here I said already there are two commands. So how it is installed in your system? Okay, how it is installed in your system? I said through the TeamViewer. Okay, through the TeamViewer. So open in the code. This is a code for that. Okay, you can see here open _ TeamViewer, and the next part you can see here send settings. So it will change all the settings of your system and will take the control of your system. Okay, this is a part of the code. And see here, among the parameters of the connect _ TeamViewer, command is the password that must be configured in the TeamViewer client. When this command is received, the banking malware starts the legitimate app and uses the accessibility services to detect its opening. That is, once it is installed in your system, right, once the RAT, that is remote access Trojan, is controlling your system, it will access the legitimate app of your system. Okay, it will access the legitimate app of your system. So the legitimate app means the original app. For example, in your system, the original bank, suppose if you are using the Federal Bank app, means it will automatically remotely will access your Federal Bank app and will get all the user details and will get the transaction details, and it will get the money also. Okay, so this Trojan is a very tricky Trojan, and it is the dangerous Trojan, right? So here how it is creating in your system means, right, that is normally in your system contains there is a password. Okay, so the remote access Trojan, it has to change the password. How it is changing the password? So code that checks if the password text field is in the current TeamViewer view. Okay, so this is the code for checking the password, right? And what are all the function it's available, right? What are all the function running behind in the system? So function that modifies the password field with the one provided by the server. Okay, so here you can see here action __argument_set_text_character_sequence. Here it is changing your password with their password. Okay, then only it will take the full control of your system. Okay, these are all the code will run behind when it is installed in your system, right? So once the TeamViewer app opening is detected, the accessibility permissions are used to modify the content of the password text field, thus enabling the remote control action. Okay, so this is the thing you can see here. The attackers, how they are attacking this. There are some parameters they have used. We'll see the two parameters. There is one is the Q parameter, and the next one is the WS parameter. The Q parameter means it is for accessing your device. Okay, the Q parameter specified here in this code, it is for accessing your device. Then WS parameter means it is there for accessing the encrypted data. Okay, accessing the encrypted data, for stealing the data, device information, etc. Okay, these are all the two main parameters they have used in that code. Okay, then it includes new features primarily designed to provide attackers with the tools necessary to remotely control the device through the TeamViewer application. So now converted into a remote access Trojan, Cerberus is renewed and reinforced and requires strengthening remote access Trojan detection measures. Okay, so first they have introduced only in the SMS, then they have introduced in the form of remote access through the TeamViewer. Okay, so this is the banking Trojan. So how to protect ourselves from this Trojan called Cerberus? So tips to avoid Cerberus. Okay, so be careful what you download. Think twice about what you download or even plug into your device. Okay, then click with caution. Only click on links from trusted sources. If you receive an email or text messages from unknown sender, I said already we have to be careful in that. Then you see the third point. Use comprehensive security, whether you are using a mobile banking app on your phone or browsing the internet on your desktop. It's important to safeguard all your devices with an extra layer security. So security is the important thing. So our system should have some security features. Okay, use robust security feature, McAfee Total Protection, so you can connect with confidence. Okay, so these are all the things we have seen that. So we have seen about the phishing threat. We have seen about the malware threat. Then we have seen about two important mobile banking Trojan during this pandemic. One is the Evenbot and the next one is the Cerberus. Okay. And one more attack during this pandemic is the ransomware. Okay. Ransomware, it's an important one, and everyone knows about ransomware. What is ransomware? So what is ransomware? It is a malicious software. It will lock your files or it will lock your system. Okay, lock your files means the files will be available, but it is in the form of encryption. Okay, it is in the form of encryption. We don't know what encryption method they have used there. So we cannot decrypt the files. So, and they will demand the ransom. If we pay the ransom only, they will unlock the files or unlock the system. Okay, so ransomware attack is a malicious software. So the main thing it does is to lock the data of the victim's computer or the device. It encrypts the data and no one can access the data afterwards. Okay, I said it's in the form of encryption. The files will be available, okay, but it is in the form of encryption. So if you pay that particular amount only, they will open the file. So to regain access, this malware demands money, okay, it demands the ransom. So for example, how much amount it's demanding, it's around $200 to $500. But there is no assurance that if you pay the ransom also, they will unlock the files or not. Okay, so this is about the ransom. So where does the ransom play? The ransomware locks your personal files. It will lock your gallery, financial information, sensitive data, etc. So even if after locking, your data will still be on your device, but it is an encrypted form. Okay, so your computer or mobile device become inaccessible. You cannot do anything. If it's locked, means you cannot do anything, right? So what are all the major types of ransomware available? So in the ransomware, we know what is the ransomware, but there are some types available in this ransomware. So we will see that one by one. The first one is the Locky. Okay, Locky means it infects the operating system, right? It infects the operating system and it completely locks all the files of your applications, right? And I said the files will be encrypted. Here they have used, they are using the AES encryption. That is the advanced encryption standard. Okay. So after that, your computer or mobile device becomes inaccessible. Okay. Mainly this Locky ransomware, it is spreading through the email messages. It's spreading through the email messages. Okay. Then that's the first type. And the second type is the crypto malware. Okay, crypto malware means it's a very dangerous ransomware, right? It encrypts the files, including the hard drives. Okay, we know everyone knows that in 2017, there is a major ransomware attack happened that is called as WannaCry, and it locks the many of the system, that is Windows OS. Right, and they demand the ransom in the form of cryptocurrency, in the form of Bitcoin only, they demand it. Okay, that's the crypto malware. right? So the first type is the Locky, and the second type is the crypto malware, and the third type is it is a software that smartly acts like a cleaning tool or an antivirus software. Why I am saying the different types of malware means in this ways the ransomware is attacking. Okay, normally we should not think that it will lock the files through the email messages like that, but in different ways it's attacking. We should know that because I am explaining here the types of ransomware. Okay, Scaryware, so it is a software that smartly acts like a cleaning tool. Okay, when we use the system, lot of pop-up messages will come. Your antivirus software should get renewed. You click here, then you can do the renewal here, and this is the cleaning tool. You can clean your system, but we should not click that. Okay, we should not click that. It is the major ransomware. After that, they will demand the money. Okay, so it either locks the device or floods the screen with the pop-up messages and the alerts. Okay, then the fourth type of ransomware is the Key Ranger. Okay, this malicious software infects the macOS. Okay, that's a Key Ranger. And the next type is the Doxware. Okay, it's a risky ransomware. Okay, it threatens that what it will threaten means threatens that your stolen information would be posted online in case if you refuse to pay the ransom. Okay, imagine the corporates are having lot of confidential data. If they threaten like that, if you are not paying the ransom, we will post that in online. If they threaten like that, immediately they will pay the money and they will get back the details. Okay, so like that, all the ransomware will act. So that is called as Doxware. Okay, then the next one is Jigsaw. Okay, Jigsaw means, right, it deletes the encrypted files one by one until you pay the money. Okay, it will not keep the files also. It will delete one by one and it will threaten you. I am deleting this file and I deleted the second one and I deleted the third one. If you are not paying the ransom, I will delete fully. So immediately, what is the other way? How to pay, and we have to recover our files. Okay. And the last one is the GoldenEye. So it targets human resources department and spreads the social engineering campaign. Okay, in these ways the malwares are ransomware are attacking. So at any cost we should not click the particular link from the unknown sources or the pop-up messages. Okay, so these are the types of ransomware. Then what is the target of the ransomware attacks? Okay, the main targets are organizations holding sensitive information. The main targets are organization holding sensitive information. So organization that carries social security numbers, medical records, financial data, patent details, that's IPR details, budgets. These are all the important data. Okay. So the ransomware also try to attack these type of organizations because they need the data immediately. So they will pay the ransom, right? Then the next one is system with less security. For example, colleges, universities, right? Like corporate central will not, the colleges, universities will not have the security features, right? Protection. So it will attack the college, universities easily, the ransomware. Then the third one is the healthcare. Hospitals, mainly the hospitals, because the hospital, the healthcare contains the patient data. If you treat the patient in a very critical situation, immediately means we need that file, but the file is locked by the ransomware. Okay, then human resources department. How it's attacking the human resources departments? It's very interesting one. Actually, some applications will come from the particular person. And what the HR will think, some applications came from so and so. He has a lot of qualification and experiences and everything. So we can open his resume like that. So when he opens his resume, immediately the ransomware will be attacked on his system. Okay, that is attacking the human resource departments. Then organizations that pay immediately, right? For example, banks, medical records, government agencies, right? They need the documents immediately. So immediately they will pay the amount and they will recover the files, right? So in these are all the areas ransomware attacks are happening. Okay, then so how to protect ourselves from ransomware, right? So keep the OS and apps up to date all the times. Do use trustable and updated antivirus systems. Then never access .zip attachments, okay? Should not access the .zip attachments. Then use security software, up-to-date security software. Then do not open the email and attachments of the unknown sender. Then do backup the data to the external hard drive, okay? So this is about the ransomware. So these are all the different attacks of COVID-19. That's a cyber attacks during COVID-19. We have seen that. We have seen phishing, malware, then event bot, Cerberus, ransomware. Okay. And the last one. The last one is the main thing, work from home. Okay. Everywhere now work from home, right? Because of the... So we are, everyone are busy doing the online work, right? At the same time, cyber criminals are also busy. Through that, how we can do the attack, okay? So another threat following outrage of COVID-19, giving sleepless nights, encouraging people to stay at home and help communities to spread the coronavirus. So there is an increase in the number of cyber attacks on computers, routers, and unprotected home networks used by employees who have switched to remote working due to spread of COVID-19. Okay, because of this unprotected home networks, cyber criminals are hacking lot of data. They are hacking the corporate's data also because corporate people are also working at home. Okay, they are doing an online everything. So there is no protection. There is no much protection everywhere. In the network, okay, in all the home there is no much protection. So cyber criminals are actively doing their work. Okay, so here, since many countries have advised their citizens to work from home, to learn from home, because children also studying, right? Cyber security threat issues need more focus, which can avoid more misleading issues on individuals and working places. So there is a survey, that's a National Technical Research Organization. It's reported that due to work from home, lot of cyber attacks have been increased. Okay, then so the record says many divisions of public enterprises, government endeavors, power transport, telecom, banking are at the risk of more attacks during this pandemic. Okay, so here work from home, the major safety measures during this work from home option, right? The virtual private network, right? Virtual private network is the lifeboat for organizations and institutions nowadays, and their availability will be a major focus from now on. Now, you can see here, over 9,000 coronavirus themed attacks have been noticed in India in this work from home option. That is from 2nd February till 2nd May, okay? 9,000 coronavirus attacks, right? So between February and May, now it is July, definitely it has increased more, okay? Then, so how to expand our security, okay? How we have to protect ourselves, how to expand our security. So improve the security of our home network. Then install the latest version of antivirus software on your computer and mobile devices. Then manage your social media privacy settings properly. Okay, that's very, very important because nowadays everyone are in social media, right? So the settings should be very properly maintained. Then create a strong password and more secure account. You have to change your password regularly, right? Then you should create the strong password and you should not use common password for everything, okay? For your banking application and for your email, For everything, you should not use the common password. Then protect your mobile devices and financial data. Then teach best internet safety for safety practices to your family. Okay, because everyone are in online now. Then keep your kids safe online. They are studying online, right? Then take steps to have a virtual security team. Then don't click the pop-up windows. I said already, should not click the pop-up windows. Then avoid unofficial marketing bulk SMS and emails. Okay. In this way, we can expand our security, right? Then, So here I have listed out some of the cyber security tools. Now we don't have time to explain that. So I have listed out what are all the important tools available. Wireshark, it's a network analyzer tool, and these are all the free source tools only. Then Nmap, networking map, network scanner, and exploration tool. Then Kain and Able, it's a password cracker tool, and it's also open source. Then NTFS Walker for the recovering files. Okay, these are all the important tools available in the cyber security. So if there is any query, you can mail to me, shinyadvin@gmail.com. Otherwise, you can do the tweet at shinyadvin. So thank you.
Thank you. Dr. C. Emily Chaini, ma'am. It was a wonderful, awesome, and a lengthy, long session. And there was so much of information, and you had given so much of knowledge and intellectual for our hunger for the knowledge in cybersecurity. And thank you so much for sharing your expertise and knowledge with us. And sharing, thank you for giving your time in midst of your busy schedule. And now I invite Professor Sharon Nisha, ma'am, to deliver the vote of thanks.
My immense pleasure to take this opportunity to offer vote of thanks. I want to thank Lord Almighty for helping us to conduct this webinar. I want to thank our eminent resource person, Dr. C. Emily Shining, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am, for your spending valuable time in spite of your busy schedule. I thank all the participants for guiding and seeking through this webinar. Thank you, one and all. Finally, thank the management and the head of the department, Professor P. Brinda, ma'am, for supporting, and all the faculties of Cancer Savvy Engineering College for their support. Thank you, one and all.